Penguin Random House Audio presents State of War, MS-13 and El Salvador's World of Violence. This is the author, William Wheeler. Introduction. Israel Tikas is racing down the highway, drumming his hands on the wheel of the Beast, a tall, boxy police service truck that he aims at the small, bustling town of San Luis Talpa, about 25 miles south of El Salvador's capital, San Salvador. A decades-long veteran of the security forces, Tikas' first job was as an artist in the counterterrorism unit, sketching suspected guerrillas during the country's 1979 to 1992 civil war. "I was the last person these guys would see before the person who killed them," he tells me flatly. The experience left him equally as distrustful of the right-wing generals he had served as of the guerrilla commanders who had joined them among the political elite at war's end. In most ways, the country has never quite recovered since. In 2015, homicides in El Salvador rivaled the most violent peak of the civil war, and it ranks consistently among the world's most violent nations. Before long, Tika spots a body by the roadside. "It's fresh," he observes, "with clothes on. It hasn't been stripped or dismembered. The victim," he says, "was likely shot at that spot during the night." Tikas calls himself a lawyer for the dead. A self-taught forensic criminologist, he locates and digs up the bodies of victims of gang killings. And in so doing, he documents the crimes of the country's notorious maras. On this hot March morning in 2018, his finger is wrapped thick with gauze. A few days earlier, he pricked it on a thorn covered in fluids from decomposing cadavers. His belt is adorned with a skull and crossbones pattern. As always, he carries a pistol and a handbag at his side. But we aren't here for the body by the roadside. Instead, we stop outside a two-story concrete building where men in blue and white camouflage uniforms armed with assault rifles are milling about. Our security detail piles into a Toyota Hilux, and we follow them zigzagging out of town and into the surrounding sugarcane fields, the convoy kicking up a bright cloud of swirling dust. Our destination is a site used by members of the local MS-13 clique to rape, torture, and execute people. The victims include civilians, rivals from the Barrio 18 gang, and their own members who break internal codes of discipline. After a few minutes, the convoy stops at a parched basin beside the fields, a spot where a river runs during the wetter months. "As the river rises and falls in the jungle terrain," Tikas explains, "the land swells and crumbles. So the topography has all changed since the site was in use several years ago, and his informant has struggled to remember where all the bodies are buried. Still, Tikas has managed to find 11 of the 21 remains his informant says are buried here. The attorney general gave Tikas 3 months to work the location, and today is the deadline. He thinks he can find one more before his time is up, and he's brought the informant here to help." Tikas' informant is a lanky young man who wears a balaclava to hide his face. The night of the murder was his initiation, when he got a call and was summoned to the site. When he arrived, he was told to dig a hole. A woman would be killed. The woman and her partner had recently moved to town, and the clique suspected the couple had problems with MS-13 elsewhere. After an investigation, the gang disappeared her partner. Grief-stricken, the woman confronted members of the clique, screaming at them in the street, threatening to tell the police. The clique decided to kill her as well. A civilian was instructed to get the woman drunk in her home, just up the road from the burial site. Then she would be brought to the informant. His job, the informant was told, would be to cut her head off, to prove you have balls. But one of the gang members rushed the job and struck her in the back of the head with a machete. She wandered the house in a stupor, like a zombie, smearing her blood on the walls. So he struck her again, and again, and again. Tikas asks if the victim died in her house or whether they finished her off at the burial ground. "She was in agony," the informant says, "but not dead. They removed her clothes and dragged her here, then began to chop her up." Tikas and his team shovel out the topsoil until they reach hard-packed earth, then sweep away the dust with brooms. He surveys the crust, looking for a patch of discolored soil, a sign that something has been altered. With his fingers, he traces the boundaries of what he sees in the dirt. His men dig down a layer around its perimeter, then level the ground flat. He draws the outline again, and they dig a layer deeper. Gradually, an oval silhouette appears, the result of soil that has been dug up, oxygenated, and repacked. Tikas works the site laterally, instructing his men to dig a trench beside the cavity. They sift the dirt they extract through a sieve, looking for any clues the perpetrators or the victim might have left behind. Tikas moves around the grave in a dizzying pattern, fishing out roots and rocks, working his way around the hole like a pool shark. The cavity has roughly the shape of the African continent. In the lower right corner, about where Tanzania might be, is a fist-sized hole. He reaches elbow deep into it and feels what he knows by touch to be a human pelvic bone. It most likely belonged to a woman, the hole having been formed by the decomposition of the fleshy mass around her hips. Over several hours, he combs away the dirt, exposing a human skeleton. Its head is bent backward, as if in supplication. "It's weird," says the informant. He was sure they had buried her deeper. The limbs seem largely intact, with bits of tattered clothing around them. Tikas clears away dirt from the skull. He uses a turkey baster to clean the scalp, then fishes out broken shards from its face. "Talk to me," he mutters to the bones. "What do you want to tell me?" After reconstructing her neck, vertebrae by vertebrae, Tikas gathers her ribs into a pile by the spine. He notes the slash marks on her breastbone. "Something else is amiss. The informant's victim would have suffered machete wounds to the back of the head, but this cranium is intact. Instead, the front of the skull shows signs of being hacked repeatedly." Tikas concludes, in the end, that it belongs to a different woman altogether, a name that was not on the informant's list. It's the third body they have found here that the informant knew nothing about. "We haven't even found a quarter of the fucked up things these assholes have done," says a member of the police detail keeping watch over Tikas and his crew. He too wears a mask, with an assault rifle slung over his shoulder, in case the gang's spotters are watching. Of late, the gang has been disappearing off-duty members of the police and military and their families. The murders that occurred here happened in the middle of a truce that the government negotiated between the rival gangs, which was credited with cutting the homicide rate in half. But the reality, the informant says, is that it taught them to hide their victims in clandestine graves like these. Tikas was not formally trained in forensics, and many of the techniques he uses he discovered himself. But he's not the only one learning in the process. First, he noticed that the gangs had begun dismembering corpses so they would fit into smaller holes, making them tougher to spot. Later, they began stabbing the corpses in the stomach and throat before burying them in order to release gases trapped inside, so the decomposition process would leave an even smaller cavity. As they worked to cover up their crimes with increasing sophistication, they even joked that they were making it a challenge for Tikas, the informant tells him. The informant had lived in the United States for a decade when, in 2013, he was suddenly deported after missing a court appointment, he says. As soon as he arrived at his family's house in El Salvador, members of MS-13 showed up at his doorstep. "Everyone here must collaborate," they told him. He started as a lookout, but before long they said he knew too much about them and would have to join the gang. Today, at 24, he's already committed 31 murders, he claims. His manner is earnest and agreeable, but Tikas tells me the informant would just as soon murder us all. "We have a working relationship," Tika says, "but he's a psychopath." A few months ago, the informant fell out of favor with his clique. His first offense was unauthorized drinking. Members have to ask for permission before consuming alcohol, since intoxication renders them unreliable. Then, shortly after, he survived a police ambush. The gang assumed he was a collaborator, and they tried to kill him, though he survived again. So he went to the police and said he could give them information.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.